Welcome to this next lecture about disturbing functions. We are going to continue disturbing function, and in particular we will use disturbing functions for finding amplitude and periodic and frequency of periodic orbits. Of course, we should again note that this is only an approximation method. We will also see some conditions under which disturbing function provides us a guarantee of existence of periodic orbits, and some other conditions which is a guarantee for non-existence, a necessary condition for existence and a sufficient condition for non-existence. Sorry, I might have gone wrong in this. We will see a sufficient condition for existence of periodic orbits and a sufficient condition for non-existence of periodic orbits. So, the last thing we noted was that if we have a feedback loop like this, we had reviewed disturbing functions. We also derived the disturbing function for the jump hysteresis. That was an example of a nonlinearity with memory. The memory aspect about it also brought in an imaginary part of the disturbing function, because the other nonlinearities that we had considered, namely the dead zone, the signum nonlinearity and the saturation nonlinearity, were all memoryless. They were odd. That is why they happened to be real. They had only a real part. But then the jump hysteresis also depends on the rate of change, the sign of the rate of change of the input signal, input sinusoid. That is what brought in the imaginary part also. So, today we are going to see how to find the amplitude and period and frequency of periodic orbits. What we will not see in this course is stability of the limit cycle. Of course, this periodic orbit is already a limit cycle. Stability of limit cycles. What this means is, of course, we have just seen, we are seeing some conditions for existence of these periodic orbits, whether for closely for initial conditions that are perturbed from the periodic orbit, if it is an initial condition close to this orbit but not on the periodic orbit, do those trajectories also converge to this periodic orbit? In that case, we will call this periodic orbit, we will call this limit cycle a stable limit cycle, or do they go away? So, let us see what happens in the case of linear systems. There we had already noted very early that we have a continuum of periodic orbits, and that is the situation that we will just verify again using the disturbing function method also. So, please come back to this figure. So, we started with some point here. It is important to note that the amplitude and frequency of the periodic orbit that we obtain, the frequency of course is the same throughout anywhere on this orbit, but the amplitude that we obtain by calculations is amplitude of the sinusoid at the input to the nonlinearity. It is not the amplitude at this point, it is the amplitude of the sinusoid at this point, but the frequency of course remains the same everywhere inside this loop. So, let us take an example. So, consider again g of s with g equal to 1 over s plus 1, s plus 2, s plus 3 connected with constant k in the feedback. Yeah. Now, this is like solving for 1 plus k g of s r of t equal to 0. Notice a close relation with Nyquist plot. Yeah, we start from a point here, we call this r of t, it goes through gain k, then minus k after going through this point, and then minus g k. Yeah, that acts on r is same as r. That equation gives us this. Yeah, for non-trivial periodic solution. if there should be a non-trivial periodic solution, let's assume that this r of t is equal to a sine omega t. That gives us 1 plus k g of j omega equal to 0. Yeah, this is like asking for what value of k. Yeah, the k has to be real. Yeah, we allow amplification only by real numbers, positive or negative. That is a minor issue. Is there some value of k such that this becomes equal to 0? Yeah, the fact that k has to be real means that the Nyquist plot of g has to intersect the real axis. If k has to be positive, then it also means that g of j omega, real part of g of j omega, has to be negative. If k has to be positive for this equation to be satisfied for any omega, yeah, if this should be satisfied for some omega, then these conditions have to already be true. So plot, Nyquist plot of this transfer function, we already noted, was equal to this. This is a point minus 1, this is 1 by 6, and this we already noted is minus 1 by 60, and that happens to be at omega is equal to square root of 11 radians per second. Of course, plus minus both, plus square root of 11 and minus square root of 11 both. Yeah, that is indeed the Nyquist plot intersects at two points here. Now for k not equal to, for k not equal to 60, 1 plus k g of j omega, no solutions. Yeah, for k equal to 60, 1 plus k g of j omega equal to 0, indeed equal to 0 at omega is equal to square root of 11. Yeah, let us take only positive frequency, of course minus square root of 11 also, but so what? I mean, it just means that the periodic solution, we have two solutions so that the signal eventually is real. To get a real signal, we need two independent complex sinusoids, which when we add by a linear combination, we get a real signal. That is the reason that we have minus square root of 11 also. That is besides the point when dealing with real signals. So now, at k equal to 60 alone, this equation has a solution for some omega. When k is not equal to 60, this particular thing does not, yeah, it does not have a solution for any omega. So now, let us see at k equal to 60. Yeah, at k is equal to 60, we get at k equal to 60 and omega equal to square root of 11, we obtain 1 plus 60 times minus 1 by 60, this acting on a sine square root of 11 t equal to 0. Yeah, this is a differential equation. Yeah, if there were dependence on omega here, one should interpret it as differentiating this. What we are writing here is a differential equation when applied to this particular sinusoid. Yeah, when applied to sinusoid is when the frequency very conveniently comes as g evaluated at j omega. So this we get is equal to 0 for all a, yeah, for any amplitude. Yeah, so if you ensure that k is equal to 60 and the frequency omega is equal to square root of 11, then the periodic orbit inside this particular figure . So indeed a sine square root of 11 t is a periodic solution here when k is equal to 60 and this transfer function, this system. Yeah, for any a, yes, yeah, answer to this is yes, which means continuum of periodic orbits. Yeah, it is not isolated, it is not for just a very specific value of a that you have a periodic orbit, you have a continuum. Yeah, this is, in a way this is not good, What is bad about this? If you are building an oscillator in the laboratory, after some time you want that it stabilizes to a fixed period. We don't want that any period is possible. Yeah. Of course, another worse situation is for arbitrarily small perturbations. We might have for arbitrarily small perturbations in the plant, in the system information. It might turn out that we have instability. We don't have a sustained oscillation, but we have instability, or these sustained or these oscillations just die down to zero, depending on whether this gain 60 turns out to stabilize or causes instability. Depending on that, these oscillations might either die down to zero or they might blow up. Yeah, this is inevitable because this is a linear time invariant system. What about for k larger than 60? We know that again we can't have periodic solutions. In fact, for any initial condition we have instability. For any non-zero initial condition we have instability of the closed loop. Yeah. So the next thing to ask is, we are going to replace this block by the saturation nonlinearity. So we have the standard saturation nonlinearity here. We have a block K. Notice that as soon as we have this, we will in fact be able to set what amplitude we want. Yeah. So this is eta, this is the nonlinearity which we will try to plot. We already saw last time that this is how it looks. Yeah. So now we want to evaluate 1 plus k eta a g of j omega equal to 0. Find k, a and omega such that, for the time being, why don't we just take k equal to 1? Yeah, let's take k equal to 1. This is our complex plane. Nyquist plot of g we already plotted like this. What is conventionally done is that plot g of j omega and minus 1 over eta a, yeah, on complex plane. Luckily, these both are kind of independent. What is independent about this? This depends only on omega and this depends only on a, because this nonlinearity is memoryless, it doesn't depend on frequency explicitly. Hence, this is some locus of points for different values of a, and it is some curve in the complex plane that is parameterized only by the parameter a, the amplitude. Yeah, so we can plot these both independently and check where they intersect. Look for intersection points. Intersection points. To say that k is equal to 1 in this equation, to say that 1 plus eta a times g of j omega equal to 0 means g of j omega equal to minus 1 by eta a, eta of a. This means that these two curves intersect at that particular complex number. When they intersect, you look at what amplitude this curve has reached that point, at what frequency omega that curve has reached that point, and that gives you the a and omega of the periodic orbit. Only that we should note that the amplitude is amplitude of the sinusoid at the entry to the nonlinearity. Yeah, please note that this is again an approximate analysis. Why? Because the describing function has taken only the first order harmonic. One might say that if G has low pass characteristics, yeah, if the higher harmonics all have very small amplification, then that results in pretty good accuracy of this periodic orbit. Yeah, if G has a good roll off, yeah, if the difference in the degrees of numerator denominator is 2 or more, then this indeed is a valid approximation, but it should have low pass characteristics for all these arguments to work, and also the frequency omega at which it intersects should be well within the cutoff. These are only just some thumb rules, but then Vidyasagar's book makes this more precise, rigorous. So just this argument we will see in little more detail, and then we will return to this saturation nonlinearity example. So consider 1 plus eta a g of j omega, most convenient. What is the convenient aspect about this? Eta depends only on A and not omega. Plot G of J omega and minus 1 by eta of A simultaneously in the complex plane. Yeah, for different omega and A. So in the example that we have been seeing, this is G of J omega for different values of omega. What about minus 1 by eta of A? Notice that for our example, we had this as eta of A. So minus 1 of eta of A, so this is the point minus 1 for this value is equal to 1 until amplitude equal to 1, because we are dealing with the standard saturation nonlinearity. The saturation nonlinearity that causes amplification 1, exactly 1, for all amplitudes up to A equal to 1, for all A sin omega t inputs up to A equal to 1, beyond that it just saturates to 1. So for all these points, minus 1 over 1 turns out to be this point, and for A larger than that, eta of A is decreasing. So minus 1 over eta of A, this is some curve like this, yeah. So this for A less than or equal to 1, and then this is for A increasing, A greater than 1 increasing. What have we plotted? This is a curve of eta of A. It is a curve of not eta of A, but minus 1 over eta of A, starting from A equal to 0 up to A tending to infinity. This is the locus of points where the curve is stuck to this point until A is equal to 1. For A larger than 1, it starts moving in this direction. Yeah. How do we conclude this? We have plotted just eta of A versus A. One can also plot minus 1 of eta of A versus A, that we do on this part here. Sorry. This is how minus 1 over eta of A looks like. Yeah. So it stays at minus 1 until here. For larger values of A, it goes on decreasing like this. Yeah, it is the reciprocal of this multiplied by minus 1. So that, you see, it's all real. Important point to note is it is real and always negative, and the magnitude is going on increasing. Yeah, distance from the horizontal axis is just going on decreasing. Distance from the horizontal axis is nothing but distance from the origin here. That is why we have plotted the curve like this. So what is it that we have concluded from here? That this Nyquist plot for different values of omega and the curve minus 1 over eta of A for different values of A positive do not intersect at all. Yeah, they do not intersect. These two curves, this particular equation, this equation for the saturation nonlinearity with k equal to 1, of course, has no intersection. There are no periodic orbits. And not too surprising, we will see this expected using Popo criteria and the circle criteria. G of S saturation. Standard. Why don't we call this standard? Because we assume so if we have this, then no periodic orbits. Why? Because 1 plus eta of A G of J omega equal to 0 has no solution A comma omega. Here one solution is one pair A comma omega. So there is no pair A comma omega for which this equation is satisfied. So that is the reason that we had a k there. Yeah. Come back to this. We have eta of a. So why don't we pick? Yeah, why don't we pick a? Suppose we want a equal to 10 as the amplitude. Yeah. It turns out that if you have these one equation and two variables, then there might be a degree of freedom. But the degree of freedom is, in fact, doesn't have any solution. Yeah. But even if there exists a solution, the degree of freedom still may not be there. There might be a unique point that might also happen, because that is in this case happening because this intersects the real axis at only one point and this is always real. Yeah. So you can have intersection only on the real axis, and that may not be a continuum. In that sense, there may not be a degree of freedom, even though we have one equation and two unknowns a and omega. On the complex plane, they are supposed to intersect, and this eta of a is not arbitrary complex number. It is only a real number. G of j omega intersects the real axis only at omega equal to 0, omega is equal to plus minus square root of 11. These situations has first of all caused that there is no solution here. But for larger, for different, if we have parameter k, which is also again forced to be real, perhaps we can get whatever amplitude we want. That is the part that we are going to see next. So we will look at this standard saturation nonlinearity. Suppose we want a equal to 10, yeah, and suppose for a equal to 10, this value turns out to be 0.08. Yeah, this value here, suppose. What is suppose about it? Ideally, we are supposed to use that particular closed form expression that we saw in the previous lecture, which we, if time permits, we will perform on Scilab and indeed show that suppose for a equal to 10, the value here is 0.08. Notice that this curve has this nice property that for any value larger than 1, for every amplitude, there is a unique gain that intersects here. Yeah. So, in other words, this map eta of a is 1 to 1 for all values of a larger than 1. It is a 1 to 1 map. So, suppose 0.08 is the value here. Now, we can plug in this. So, 1 plus 0.08 times k times g of j omega equal to 0. We also know that k is real, all this quantity is real. For this to have a solution, g of j omega has to also be real. Yeah, we know that this can happen only at omega equal to 0 or at omega equal to square root of 11. Omega equal to 0 is not interesting because it is a periodic orbit with frequency equal to 0. Yeah, it is not really a periodic orbit, it is DC gain. So, we are going to put omega is equal to square root of 11, by which we are going to now solve this equation for k, 1 plus 0.08 times k times minus 1 by 60. Why? Because g of s evaluated at s is equal to j square root of 11 is nothing but our real axis, negative real axis intersection, which we saw was equal to minus 1 by 60. This is nothing but this point is equal to minus 1 over 60. If this should be equal to 0, this gives us an equation in k. Yeah, so k is nothing but equal to 60 divided by 0.08. Let's just calculate this. Calculations, this turns out to be 750. Yeah, it is little more than 10 times of this, because if this were 0.1, this would have been 600, but it is less than 0.1 and hence is little more than 600. So it turns out to be 750. Of course, noting that this is approximate. Yeah. So we expect that for gain as large as 750 is when we get amplitude equal to 10. For g of s with saturation nonlinearity, standard and with k equal to 750, there is a minus sign here. Then we have 10 sine square root of 11 t as approximate periodic solution. In this way, we can set the frequency, we can set the amplitude, frequency we are not able to set because g of j omega intersects the negative real axis, it intersects the real axis only at omega equal to 0 and omega is equal to plus minus square root of 11. There is no choice of frequency for the standard saturation nonlinearity, but the amplitude can be set. It may not be exactly 10 because the deserving function method is only an approximation procedure, but there is an isolated amplitude only. Only for a very particular value of a will this have a periodic orbit. That is what makes this method to be useful as for building an oscillator of a fixed amplitude. Unlike linear systems where we end up having a continuum of periodic orbits. One can also check that this is pretty robust to perturbations inside the system parameters also. Also for nearby initial conditions, it comes back to this, that of course we argued using that for oscillations smaller than this, it ends up blowing up because this range 750 happens to be making it unstable, but it is chopping it to value 1, that is why it indeed can't become unstable. That is what makes this limit cycle as a stable limit cycle. Before we see another example in which the frequency also can be set, we will proceed a little further with this example, and we will relate how for k less than 60, we already know that there can't exist periodic orbits using the circle or the Popov criteria. Yeah, both these criteria are relevant in this particular case. So, coming back to this particular figure, g of s. The saturation nonlinearity is pretty easy to visualize, but we have defined a word called standard that is actually not so standard across the literature. That is why I will just define this again. Input u, output y, in which up to 1, between minus 1 and 1, it has amplification by exactly 1. This is a line with slope 1. Beyond that, it has slope 0. In other words, it has saturated. This is what we refer to as the standard saturation nonlinearity. Yeah. Now, we can ask the question, this minus sign is also important. That is why we have 1 plus k eta a times g of j omega equal to 0. One might ask for k less than 60, yeah, for k less than 60, this deserving function, you see one can directly multiply the k with the deserving function also. Yeah, we already have a here, eta of a, we can multiply this by, let us say, 50 times eta of a, so that it is a deserving function of this nonlinearity as a whole, these two blocks together. So, this times starts from 50 and comes down, so that minus 1 by this. So, Nyquist plot is like this. G of j omega, what is this point? This point here is minus 1 by 60. On the other hand, it is here it starts, and this is minus 1 over 50 times eta a. Yeah, the plot of this whole block is this. Yeah, plot of 50 or times eta a has been plotted here. So, minus 1 over that starts from a little closer point, minus 1 is here, it has come to minus 1 by 50, it has come much closer than what it was, but the point for intersection is minus 1 by 60. So, we can conclude that for k less than 60, no intersection. What is the meaning that there is no intersection? No solution to the equation 1 plus k eta a g of j omega. By solution, we mean here a omega k triple. And there is no k, a and omega value that satisfies this for k less than 60. Of course, for a real greater than 0, for omega real. We are also working under this constraint. What is the meaning that omega is real and positive? It means that it is a sinusoid. Yeah, plus or minus omega is less important, but omega is real is required for it to be pure sinusoid. A is positive, that is because it's an amplitude and it's real number. And k less than 60 is what this condition says. From the Nyquist plot intersecting at minus 1 by 60, and eta of A by itself starts at equal to plus 1 and only decreases after that, this equation has a solution only for k larger than 60. K greater than 60 has unique solution. What about for k equal to 60? It has unique solution k, a and omega. Of course, omega is always fixed, equal to square root of 11 radians per second. But what is the amplitude that you can get? That amplitude depends on the value of k. There is a one-to-one correspondence between the amplitude and k. For each amplitude that you want, you have a value of k. If you want amplitude less than 1, there is a non-uniqueness there. It's for amplitudes larger than 1 that you have some uniqueness coming from the gain k. Why? Because for k equal to 60, yeah, continuum of periodic orbits, and all these periodic orbits have a less than or equal to 1. Yeah. So, this is not hard to check. I think that this is a very good exercise to pursue, that how for k equal to 60, it is indeed expected that you can have many periodic orbits, a continuum of periodic orbits, all of them having amplitude at most 1. What is continuum about it? A equal to 0.65 works as an amplitude, A is equal to 0.65001 also works as an amplitude. In other words, it is a continuum. Why? Because for k equal to 60, there is a range for which the saturation nonlinearity in the linear range itself already has a continuum. The amplitude can't be larger than 1, because that is when the nonlinearity starts having its effect, and then it will clip. So, this is something that one can check as an exercise. Now, we are going to use the Popov criteria to say that for k less than 60, of course, no solution is expected. Yeah, all these periodic orbits can exist only for k larger than 60. So, for that purpose, we are going to say for k less than 60, yeah, saturation nonlinearity, with saturation nonlinearity, not the standard one now. We are going to say the standard one together with this block. This whole nonlinearity we can think of, yeah, as nonlinearity in the sector 0 to k. Yeah, this is some nonlinearity inside this sector 0 to k. K is of course positive, we expect k is positive in these arguments. Input u, output y, here is our sector. This is a line with slope k, and of course, the line with slope 0 is this horizontal axis. So, this is our sector 0 to k. Does the saturation nonlinearity lie inside the sector? Yeah, very much. For each k, it is equal to this. So, the sector, so the saturation nonlinearity indeed lies inside this. Yeah, in fact, it lies inside this, because for some range, it is equal to this line for some range of the input. For input in the range plus minus 1. So, now we want to ask for up to what value of k will you have stability for all nonlinearities inside this range, inside this sector. Yeah, for what value of k will you have stability? Stability, absolute stability means that there for every initial condition the trajectories go to 0, and what is absolute about it? For all nonlinearities inside this sector. Yeah, all nonlinearities, one might further distinguish between time invariant or time varying, which makes a distinction between the circle criteria and the Popov criteria. So, Popov criteria applies to only sectors of the type 0 to k. So this is how the Nyquist plot is. The circle criteria, I will draw a more correct figure where it is tangent more properly. Consider g of s equal to 1 over s plus 1, s plus 2, s plus 3. What is the problem that we are trying to solve now? For this example, non-linearity. Specifically, what non-linearity are we talking about? Sector non-linearity. In 0 to k, g is fixed. Find k such that absolute stability for all for sector non-linearities in 0 to k. First, time invariant. For here we will apply the circle criteria, for here we will apply the Popo criteria. Yeah, these are the two things that we will do now. So for this we will plot the Nyquist plot in little more detail. This is where 1 by 6 is. This is Nyquist plot. This particular axis is the imaginary axis. To apply the circle criteria for the sector 0 to k means to, of course, this requires that the open loop transfer function g is already stable. Yeah, why it requires g is already stable? Because the nonlinearity, the particular linearity with slope 0 is also inside this sector, and if 0 has to cause stability, it means that the open loop also has to already be stable. Point minus 1 is somewhere there. So, circle criteria says find rightmost line. Yeah, rightmost line such that Nyquist plot is still to the right of this. Yeah, we cannot put the rightmost line here or here. The Nyquist plot has to still be to the right of this particular line. Find rightmost line L such that Nyquist plot is to the right to right side of L. So now this says that this point, this real axis, suppose this particular point is some point P, we will call this PC, C for circle. Yeah, the circle criteria is the one that tells us that this is the condition. Yeah, suppose PC is this point, then this K max that we can get from the circle criteria is nothing but minus 1 over PC, the real part. PC, we are looking at the real axis intersection of this vertical line. So, we push this line as much to the right until it touches, then PC. We will extract out the real axis intersection. It will be a negative point for this example. Importantly, minus 1 by 60 is further here. Yeah. So, we will get that by the circle criteria, PC, so suppose it is approximately equal to minus 1 by 50. Yeah. Why do we know that this point minus 1 by 50? It should be some point to the left, yeah, to the left of this point. Yeah, this point is minus 1 by 60. Yeah, and the Nyquist plot of course, this point can't be to the right here. It would have intersected already. It would be further to the left because this point, this curve is intersecting this at an angle. Here, if we draw a vertical one, then it will indeed be tangential here. But here it is coming and cutting and going in. It is not coming in vertically here, but going inwards. Hence, it would have come further out and then gone in. Hence, the point that is tangential to this would be tangent at some point here. Yeah, no, it would not have been tangential at the real axis intersection, which would have happened here. So, we know that this point minus this PC point is to the left of minus 1 by 60. Yeah, that is why I have taken minus 1 by 50. Yeah, then K max by circle criteria equal to 50 then. Yeah, and we already knew no periodic orbits for saturation nonlinearity. We already knew that there are no periodic orbits for saturation nonlinearity for k less than 60. We have got a number which is going to be less than 60. We have got just 50. Why is it expected that we will get a lower number? The circle criteria and also the Popov criteria are not conservative. Yeah, in some slightly more generalized sense, they are in fact necessary and sufficient. So this number 50 says because we have to guarantee absolute stability for all sector nonlinearities in the range 0 to k max, and these nonlinearities can be time varying also. The circle criteria gives us absolute stability for all nonlinearities inside the sector, which could be time varying also. On the other hand, here we have fixed the nonlinearity to be a saturation nonlinearity. Yeah, it's an extremely conservative, a very fixed nonlinearity, and hence we can get a number as large as 60. Here, on the other hand, we are supposed to guarantee absolute stability for all nonlinearities inside the sector, both time varying and time invariant. Even time invariant, there are many other nonlinearities which are time invariant other than the saturation nonlinearity. For them also, the guarantee of absolute stability has to be provided. Of course, time varying nonlinearities are another big class of nonlinearities again inside that sector. Hence, we are getting a smaller number, 50. So, up to 50, no periodic orbits, we already are able to get from circle criteria. Up to 60, no periodic orbit for the saturation nonlinearity. We can next investigate what does the Popov criteria tell us. Yeah, what is the number that we get from the Popov criteria? And before we investigate the Popov criteria, we can check up to what range of linearities, up to what sector, largest sector of linearities, what is that number? It will turn out that that number is also exactly 60. So, we are going to next see what is the maximum value of k we get for taking a sector of the type 0 to k. Yeah, this is a 0, this is a line with slope k, this is a sector, but inside this sector we can include either linearities. Linearities are nothing but lines inside the sector, all passing through 0 of course. Lines with slope, any slope between 0 and k, nonlinearities, if we say time invariant nonlinearities and time varying. Yeah, linearities of course is a small set. Why these are lines? These are just lines. Of course, they are time invariant also. The input output law does not change with time because it's a line. Time invariant nonlinearity, at least it may not be a line, but at least the dependence of output on input does not change with time. This is the output of this nonlinearity, this is the input. The dependence of output on input, if it is a line, then it is a fixed line, there is no option, it has to be at the slope only, that is a linear system. The next option is dependence output on input does not change with time, but it is a nonlinearity, for example, saturation nonlinearity. The last option is a time varying, at some point it could be like this, after some time it can become something like this, again inside this sector. So, when you inside the same sector, when you allow linearities, you can vouch for a larger value of k. Now, we expect that k max for linear, the max is the maximum sector of the type 0 to k for which you have absolute stability will be greater than or equal to k max for time invariant, and that will be larger than k max for time varying. Why is this true? Because for a given value of k max, the time varying nonlinearity set will include time invariant also, and that will include linears also. After all, linearity is also time invariant nonlinearity. It is also time varying nonlinearity, in which the time varying aspect is negligible. In fact, it is equal to 0. Yeah, so these, because of those one set sitting inside another set, if you make the set of nonlinearities allowed within a sector to be very small, then you can vouch for a larger sector. Yeah, that is the meaning of robust. How much large type of nonlinearities you want to allow within a sector? If you want to allow time invariant nonlinearities, do you want to allow time varying also? Depending on that, the sector will have to become small, so that you have absolute stability for that larger sector. So now coming back to this Nyquist plot, we will first find k max lin. Yeah, this point is minus 1 by 6t, point minus 1 is somewhere here, and this is equal to 1 by 6, real part of g of j omega, and this is the imaginary part of g of j omega. Each line inside the sector, we are speaking with respect to a very specific type of feedback configuration, in which this is where the nonlinearity is, there is this negative sign. Because of the negative sign, this minus 1 assumes its importance. Now, any point here, suppose this corresponds to minus 1 by 2, it means that it is a line, corresponds to a line with slope 2. Different lines inside a sector correspond to just points on the negative real axis. Because it is a point which is not encircled by the Nyquist plot, yeah, this is the, so g is our famous transfer function. It's open loop stable, number of poles in the right half plane is equal to 0. If you want the number of closed loop poles also to be equal to 0, the n had better be equal to 0. So this point minus 1 by 2, instead of checking the number of encirclements of the point minus 1, we have now conveniently started asking number of encirclements of this point minus 1 by 2, because this corresponds to minus 1 by k, point k, where k is the gain that we introduce to g or to this nonlinearity anywhere in the loop. It is a magnification by k, and k has to be positive for us to be considering the points on the negative real axis. So you can take any point to the left of this minus 1 by 60 and it will not be encircled. In other words, it will be encircled 0 number of times. So they will all correspond to linearities which cause stability. Yeah. So any k less than 60 will not be encircled, will imply n equal to 0. What is this n? This n is number of encirclements. Yeah, number of encirclements of which point? Of the point minus 1 by k. Yeah, if correspond to gain k, we have minus 1 by k as a point to check instead of minus 1. So this is the number of encirclements, and as long as n is equal to 0, p was already equal to 0, that gives us by the Nyquist criteria z also equal to 0, and hence we have closed loop stability. Closed loop stability, we can use Nyquist criteria precisely because we are interested in just checking points on the negative real axis. Points correspond to linear lines, and hence linear system, and Nyquist criteria is indeed applicable for linear system. Now, what does the circle criteria say? Circle criteria said that we will take So, what is this value now, k max lin? It is nothing but equal to 60. Yeah, we cannot have k max, we cannot achieve for 60, we already have periodic orbits which is instability, which is marginal stability for linear systems. So we cannot achieve this max, we can call it k lin sup, k linearities sup. Why sup instead of max? Because we cannot achieve k lin sup equal to 60. At 60 we have marginal stability, we do not have asymptotic stability. In other words, we do not have absolute stability. What did we get for k time varying, which means circle criteria, sup again, that we got approximately 50. That requires us to take the vertical axis that is tangential to this. Yeah, this tangent point we said is to the left of the point minus 1 by 60. We said it's approximately minus 1 by 50, that corresponds to 50 as a sector. Now our next, we are going to use the Popo criteria, and we might get some number that is between this, might be strictly less than 60, might be strictly more than 50, or it could be equal to one of these, that we are not sure at this point. For that purpose, we will plot the Popo plot. Yeah, we will sketch the Popo plot for this particular transfer function. So recall that the Popo criteria involved sketch Popo plot, which amounts to plotting like the Nyquist plot, plot the real part of g of j omega, but on the vertical axis plot omega times imaginary part of g of j omega. This particular quantity is a even function of omega, because the imaginary part itself is an odd function, to that we have multiplied by omega. So it is enough to plot this for only positive values of omega. For this particular transfer function, Nyquist plot was coming down. So this means that we are taking the Nyquist plot and just distorting it along the vertical axis. Only along the imaginary axis we are doing some distortion, along the horizontal axis there is no, because we are still plotting the real part. So perhaps it looks like this. It still goes to 0 in this case, because imaginary part of g of j omega goes to 0 pretty fast, and multiplying by omega can't change the rate at which it goes to 0. This requires a careful check. We can verify this after some time. So the, what does the Popo criteria say? Take any line with positive slope. Yeah, that this line should have positive slope, and this Popo plot should be to the right of this line. Yeah, because it has positive slope, to its right is unambiguous. It is easy. The real part of every point on the Popo plot should be greater than this, should be greater than the, this line with positive slope should be above and to the left of the Popo plot. Named, in other words, the Popo plot should be to the right and below of this particular line. Now we can ask, as long as this line has positive slope, it is fine. But then this intersection of the negative real axis gives us the range for which we have stability, absolute stability for that sector 0 to k for time invariant nonlinearities only. Yeah, suppose this corresponds to point P, this P for point and this subscript P for Popo, then suppose PP equal to minus 1 by 20, then we have by the Popo criteria from 0 to 20 absolute stability. Absolute stability for this sector of nonlinearities, but they have to be time invariant. Yeah. Now comes, can we make the sector larger? Can we take this line just to have positive slope but further to the right? Yeah. So this point, the intersection of the negative real axis does not change, because the real axis has not changed at all. The real part of the plot that we are plotting has not changed. Only the imaginary axis has been, imaginary part of g of j omega has got scaled by omega. It has become larger for omega larger than 1. It has become smaller for omega less than 1. So how much to the right can this point come? For this particular example, it can come as much right until it intersects this. Yeah, the rightmost line would be tangential. Yeah, it is allowed to be tangential at this point. That is what makes us. So k sup, again it is a sup, because we cannot achieve this by Popo, which is same as time invariant, will be equal to 60, because the real axis intersection of the line that comes as much to the right as possible, and still the Popo plot is further to the right. And the rightmost we can bring is when it is tangential at this point. At that time the slope, the precise value of the slope is not important. That time the real axis intersection will again be equal to minus 1 by 60. So this is what the Popo, yeah, and of course 60 is not achievable, because at that point there will be an intersection. We are not going to allow intersections of this line with the Popo plot. So the Popo criteria also tells us that for all time invariant nonlinearities in the range from 0 to 60, open bracket, because 60 is not allowed, yeah, for all time invariant nonlinearity. So let us just write this conclusion from Popov criteria. Absolute stability for all time invariant nonlinearities in sector 0 to 60. Yeah, from Popov criteria we obtain and deduce that we have absolute stability for all time invariant nonlinearities inside this sector. Yeah, is the saturation nonlinearity scaled by 60 inside this sector? No, it is just outside. The saturation nonlinearity, but scaled by 60. Yeah, saturation nonlinearity. If it is scaled by 60, then the slope of this is 60, and hence it is not strictly contained inside this sector 0 to 60. Yeah, it lies on the boundary. Yeah. So if we take square bracket here, of course it will be inside this sector, but if you take scaled by 59.99, then it will be strictly inside the sector, and we had already verified using the disturbing function that there is no intersection, and hence we will not have periodic orbits. We will have periodic orbits only for k 60 or more. For k equal to 60, of course, we end up having a continuum, but for k strictly larger than 60, the Popov criteria already said that perhaps it is not going to work. Popov criteria was again only a sufficient condition. After allowing a slightly larger class of nonlinearities, it becomes necessary and sufficient condition for absolute stability. So, for time invariant nonlinearities in the range 0 to 60, describing function also told us that you do not have periodic orbits. Popov criteria guarantees absolute stability, which automatically rules out periodic orbits for any value of k strictly less than 60. Yeah, this is the conclusion that we got for k, and for linearities, of course, we already know that for k larger than 60, for k equal to 60, we have continuum of periodic orbits, because the amplitude will not matter for a linear system for k equal to 60, and for k larger than 60, we have instability for the linear system, but for saturation nonlinearity, we have a unique amplitude that we obtain from the disturbing function, and that is precisely when the Popov criteria fails to guarantee anything. In this sense, we are able to see that the disturbing function is able to give us for what amplitude and frequency we have intersection of the minus 1 by eta a plot and the g of j omega plot, and the Popov criteria is not able to guarantee absolute stability for good reason. These are all complementing each other in that sense. So, we will continue in the next lecture with another example where we are able to set both the frequency and the amplitude by choosing the nonlinearity parameters carefully. In particular, we will look into the jump hysteresis nonlinearity. This ends today's lecture. Thank you.